Greetings, my name is Jay.
And I'm Ian.
And we're back with the Gamers Gaiden. How have you been?
Pretty good, man. How are you doing?
Not too bad. What games have you been playing?
I have been playing Minute.
Okay.
Have you heard of Minute?
Is it the game where you're like a block and then you have 60 seconds to try and get as far in the level as possible?
I would say you're more of a blob than a block. But yeah, it's all black and white.
Right.
Yeah, it's really cute. It is a minute, unless you want to cut it short and kill yourself. That is an option. There is a die button.
Nope. Next.
yeah. When you realize you've done stuff way too wrong, and you have 20 seconds to go somewhere that you need to be.
Right.
Just like, forget it. I'll start over again.
Mm-hmm.
As you can hear, I've been a little bit under the weather, so it's mostly been Netflix and sleeping, but when I have found some time, Minute's been kind of perfect because I can just kind of like, I can literally play it for 5 minutes, accomplish probably something,
right?
Maybe
right.
not.
Beat a level or two.
Well, there's no level.
Oh, okay. I thought it was just different
so
like,
it's,
boards.
It's like a giant world. Mm-hmm. Think like Legend of Zelda.
Okay.
Where you have like different screens,
mm-hmm.
and each screen is like a thing.
Yep.
And yeah, each screen is kind of a thing.
Okay.
Though from what I can tell, some of the screens are not anything. Some of them are just
right.
useless filler to get you somewhere, but like mm-hmm. you'll get somewhere and you might the best thing I found was that there's a lighthouse keeper.
Oh, okay.
And he does give you really good information, but you have to get to him really quickly. And he's old and talks super slow, so it takes.
Is it like the old Nintendo games where like one character comes up at a time?
It's just like Well, most people talk really quickly,
yeah.
because that's the like gimmick is that you have 60 seconds,
right,
and
right.
there's this you know old man who talks super slow,
right?
But he does give you some piece of information,
cool.
It costs you your life.
Yeah.
But yeah, no, it's been fun. I've been enjoying it. What about you, JC? What have you been playing?
So I finally got around to beating Resident Evil 2, the Leon campaign. So I've now beaten both of them. It was pretty fun.
Now, are you gonna go back? Because I know that there's an A and B for each of them.
Yeah, not now. Maybe like later this year or something like that.
Okay.
But I'm satisfied with my RE2 remake experience. I did also try the they're like three story adventures, which are actually just like survival gauntlets. Those are like, you know, the Kendo gun shop? Or
yes.
Gun Shop Kendo?
Yes.
Yeah, like that guy, there's like a what if scenario in one of
oh.
the DLCs that they release for free, and like you just like go through like hallways and killing zombies and see if you can get to the end or something.
That's really
cool.
I
played it for like 5 or 6 minutes. I thought there'd be a little bit more story to it, like a side story, but it was just like a survival gauntlet thing. So
I mean, killing zombies is fun.
Yeah, it was kind of fun too. So I played with that a little bit after I beat it, and
nice.
Yeah, so finished that and a little bit of League. Nothing ranked for the past like week or so though, but
just some fun.
And I got Castlevania, the new one for the PlayStation 4, which is the compilation that has Symphony of the Night and Rondo of Blood. Yeah. So I've never actually played the Rondo of Blood like TurboGrafx-16 version because I didn't have a Wii whenever that version came out. I only played like the 2.5D PSP version, which is essentially the same thing, but like I've obviously aesthetically it looks different. So this is like the original, which is kind of cool to be able to like play and experience that.
Yeah.
So I think I beat three levels.
Okay.
Yeah, I got to the Minotaur dude.
So what do you think of the whole like the package as a whole? I know one of the major complaints was that it's kind of bare bones.
Yeah, I read that, but like what were they expecting? Like,
I guess that's
levels?
True. I mean,
like,
I don't
yeah.
I picked it up as well, and I don't have any issues with it either, but I know that
yeah.
that was kind of one of the major complaints.
I would agree if you're looking for more content other than like the original content, then yeah, there's nothing new to it, and it was like $25 or something.
Which isn't bad for two games. That's not bad
for two games. Personally, I'm not one who really cares. I generally just think of them as just re-releases of the games that, like, somebody who's younger can play, or I can re-experience without bringing out, like, PlayStation to replay Symphony of the Night, for example. I don't know. The only real complaint I would have, and I don't actually know if there's any validity to this, but whenever you die on the boss boards, the game really slows down.
Oh.
It doesn't slow down anywhere else, but I just thought that was weird. And I'm, like, really curious to know if, like, the TurboGrafx CD actually slowed down at that point. It doesn't make any difference to the gameplay whatsoever. But I just thought that was really interesting. Because, like, okay. I found the secret entrance on the first level and got to, like, the snake boss. And he, like, winds around the bridge. And he killed me a couple of times. And each time he'd, like, slowly go around the bridge, like, at, like, 1/3 speed. And I was like, what? Like, that's weird. But sometimes whenever the games transition to, like, a different state, then they tend to slow down too. So it's pretty good. But I really like it. The controls handle really well. It's a good way to get it, because the Wii in 2000, or WiiWare in 2010, was the only other way to get the English translation of Rondo of Blood and not 2.5D.
Okay.
So unless you, like, imported the TurboGrafx-16, but, like, the console costs an insane amount of money. So
yeah.
And then even then, the game's, like, almost $200 or something like that. Oof. I think so. But yeah, so I started playing that.
Yeah, that's pretty cool.
Yeah, but I would recommend it. If you're a Castlevania fan and you already own it, then there might not be any reason to buy it. But if you're just a passive Castlevania fan, I think it's really cool, because it has the best of both worlds. It has like, arguably one of the best classic Castlevania games, and then it has, like, the definitive Metroidvania one, right?
I'm not gonna give too much away, but we're gonna talk about it a little bit later too.
Yeah So those are the games that I've played over the last week. Cool. So today what we're gonna be talking about are favorite level designs, and we're also going to be talking about games that we didn't play when they were new until later, and we wish we had played them or kind of missed out. But those are our two segments. But we're going to start off with favorite level design.
And now you can think about what Castlevania is going to be in.
Yeah, maybe some both.
Maybe.
With favorite level designs, these are some examples that we thought were really good examples of games that had just really great design whenever it came to, like, the levels and the boards and, like, things. And Ian, why don't you start off?
Absolutely. I had a real hard time with this when JC brought it to me, because a level design was something I'd never really thought of before. But then as I kind of started putting some thought into it, they all came to me pretty quickly.
Yeah.
I know we were having a discussion about it at the time, and it's just kind of like,
we talked,
like, oh man, like,
after League, these about are like this, and you're like, oh, it's a really great idea, and then it was just like stumped. And then we talked about it for, like, maybe 20 or 30 minutes, and then all of a sudden, like, the idea started flowing.
It was just like, bam. And it wasn't the first one that jumped out to me, but it was one that I got to eventually, was the Metal Gear Solid series.
Mm-hmm.
Not as much the original Metal Gear games for the NES.
Snake's Revenge,
which isn't technically, I'm not gonna get into it. Anyways, no,
the game,
I mean,
doesn't exist. I'm aware.
I mean, like, Metal Gear Solid, Metal Gear Solid 2, which was Sons of Liberty,
mm-hmm.
Snake Eater,
which, like, the third one's, like, one of most people's favorites, right?
I know the third one's up there.
Yeah,
it wasn't for me.
Oh, okay.
Personally, the first one will always be my favorite.
Oh,
but
okay. Yeah, just brought you to the new experience. But,
like, it brought me to the series. Like, yeah. That was and it was something I had never experienced before,
mm-hmm.
on a console. Like, it was just totally different.
Yeah.
It was a completely foreign experience. A friend of mine actually told me about it.
Mm-hmm.
He said, man, I saw a commercial on TV for this game that looks really cool. I'm like, wow. And I went to I had stopped at Toys R Us with my parents, and I was like, they're like, you can get a game, because it was my birthday.
Right.
I'm like, sweet, what am I going to get? And I'm like looking, and I'm like, oh, it's that game that my friend was telling me about, from and he said it looked really cool.
Yeah.
And I'm looking at the box, and I'm like, yeah, that looks kind of cool.
Right.
Tactical espionage action. No idea what that means, but let's give it a go. I think I was in grade 9.
Right.
Maybe.
Yeah, that's about whenever it came out.
And, yeah, like, it was just so different from anything. We actually, because it, there was a bit of time, and then exam week,
mm-hmm.
there was, like, a couple months. Yeah, we got back from Christmas break, and then exam week, and we would go do exams and then go back to my house and play Metal Gear.
Right.
And that was it.
But what about the design of the okay. levels? Did you like?
I know. I'm sorry. I got way sidetracked on that. It's that. So it gives you an idea, like right from the very beginning of Metal Gear,
mm-hmm.
Metal Gear Solid, when you step out of the water and you've got the guards who will follow your wet footprints.
Right. Right.
It really it shows you new elements. Kind of as you need to know them,
mm-hmm.
you have boss fights that are very well thought out,
okay,
and unique.
Mm-hmm.
They're not a lot of just kind of like, especially for an action game,
mm-hmm.
like a third person action game. Not every boss fight is just run and shoot.
Right,
a lot of them require a little bit of extra thought. It helps to know. I mean, the Psycho Mantis thing is still, like, one of the weirdest things ever. You have to switch... If you switch over to the second controller port, he can't read your mind.
Oh, right, yes.
Yeah, right? Yeah, like, yeah, it's... Yeah. And if you have... if you have a Castlevania save on your memory card, he'll make mention of that as well.
Oh, that's really cool.
Like, it's just... Like, stuff like that. Like, it's... Mm-hmm. You know, you do have these, it is kind of, I don't want to say open world, but sort of, because you do have these, like... As the
series progresses, yeah, for sure.
It definitely progresses. It becomes
more and more, like...
I mean, Phantom Pain is, they basically give you
yeah.
a couple different sandboxes to play within.
And the whole idea of, like, the stealth in the game, too, is really well-designed as well, because it's, like, it's simple, yet it's very effective, because...
Yeah.
It gives you multiple different ways to actually take out, like, your enemies, right? You've got guns, you've got the tranquilizer guns, and you've got, like, sneaking up to them and taking them out, or
CQC.
Just bypassing them.
CQC. But yeah, it's, they make efforts to introduce elements early. Like, these are the new elements to this game. The best example I could think of was the sounds and footprints and that kind of stuff. Of the first game.
Right.
Because that wasn't really something that most people had really dealt with in video games at that point.
Mm-hmm.
Flame me if I'm wrong. I probably am. But for the most part, it's really not something that was there.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, then you have in...
The game does use more audio cues than other games, for sure.
Absolutely. And then in Snake Eater, you have the whole camouflage system. And it really gets you into that from the moment you drop in.
Right.
As well as the food, you know, hunting and eating,
mm-hmm.
all of those different elements. And then you've got your sneaking suit, or the, like, stealth suit in Guns of the Patriots.
Okay.
Which, again, it was stealth, which was really cool. But, yeah, I feel like they just kind of introduce everything in such a, I don't know. A good way.
Just a progressive way.
I'm failing at words right now. But the way they do things, and it's been such an amazing progression from what's been a contained open world
right.
design to this, like, much grander. I mean, in Phantom Pain, it's essentially like a choose your own adventure. Like, you can option not to use boss. You know, you can be one of the grunts,
mm-hmm.
and you'll rank him up, and his skills will get better, and his stats will get better.
Yeah.
But you can, you know, you can take equipment with you. You can find all your equipment on site. You know, they have that option.
Right.
Yeah. I could talk about this all day, but Metal Gear was one of the ones that kind of jumped out at me, and I was like, yeah, wow, the way they really, like, the way they set things out for you. And, mm-hmm. you know, they, the overworld design is fun enough that you can wander around, and traversal's not a pain.
Right.
But then on top of that, you have these outstanding set pieces, which are, you know, are tense and incredibly well thought out for a story that's so up its own ass.
I think one of the largest testaments to its game design and level design is that, like I've played, I think, the second one very briefly, but I played the fifth one quite a bit.
Okay.
And you never really got into a situation too often where it was like, well, what the hell am I supposed to do? Because there's always more than one way to do something. Yep. And if you... Like, I play the game much differently than my friend who, like, loves that series. It's, like, one of his favorite series. And I played it a lot differently than he did. And it's neat because you can get different game play styles. Whereas if you take something like Doom, for example, which has its own unique and good level design, but, like, that is very, like, one-dimensional. And this managed to take things into, like, different arcways in order to... to complete the same objective.
It's true. That's kind of one of my favorite things about 5 is the dropping into the mission zone.
Right. Yeah.
It gives you that option
of helicopter with your 80s music.
With my my 80s music blasting. I can either option to go, and it'll show you. It'll highlight that drop zone as red if you're going in hot. And I'll blare Kids in America while sitting on the mounted chain gun just blasting away.
Yeah.
Or sometimes I'll find the farthest one and really slowly work my way in. I love that you have that versatility. Anyways, cool. We can talk about this all day. JC?
So the first game that I'm going to go through is Super Mario Brothers 3.
Oh.
Games did what Mario did well before. In fact, Mario 1 is like the prime example of just like, telling you nothing, and then getting you to do something. You have two buttons. But the reason why I picked Mario 3 was because it didn't assume that you had never played games before. Because if you compare 1 to 3, you have a very large amount of time in comparison between the start position and the first pipe. And so it's about twice as long.
Okay.
But in Mario 3, it just throws in so much at you. Very simply, like, right away there's coins. I don't have to walk over and then see them. And then there's a piranha plant that shoots fireballs at you right away. And then you also have a, if you read the manual, I didn't read the manual, but like...
Who reads manuals?
I usually do. Because whenever I started playing games, I was actually fairly young. I was like almost 5. So... I was 4. My mom would sit down and read the manual to me so I knew how to play. And then she would kind of play the first level with me. And then, like, after my 5th game, I knew how to play.
You're on your own, kid.
I'm on my own. Figure it out. But anyway, back to Mario 3. So you just have a lot condensed. It didn't assume you had never played a game before. So if you had played any type of genre, it's very simple to pick up. It's like, there's a box with a question mark on it. What does that do? Okay, well, I'm going to go up to it and jump into it. And all of a sudden, immediately, you have an obstacle. You have the piranha plant shooting the fireballs at you. And it's like, oh, damn, I have to dodge this or otherwise I'm going to die. And it's coming in and out. And then you have the Goombas right away. And then you have a pit. And you also, right before the pit, you have the accessibility to potentially get the leaf for the Tanuki suit, and then you can fly right away.
Yeah.
So if you had read the manual, then like you're introduced to all these kinesthetically to be able to try out all the new mechanics right away. And then the world is designed like the first level because you have the little castle, which was a new introduction to that game, and it kind of set the pace for all of the like new Mario games, the non-3D games.
Yeah.
Because you have all these segregated worlds, and it has a little castle, and then how do you get rid of him? You hit him 3 times, right? And then it's like, if it's a big sprite, I have to hit it 3 times in order to kill it. So you've been conditioned in order to be like, if it's a boss monster, that's what you have to do, right? So then you finally get over to the castle, and then you go up into the airship, which, like, I could never understand why they got rid of airships. Although it's in the new Mario Brothers Wii U, and then I think the one before it as well. But okay. There's some levels, but not as many. But and then you get to the boss, and then what do you have to do? You have to hit him 3 times. You've already been taught how to kill a sub-boss, and it translates over. And you have all the different power-ups, which is kind of cool, because most games, like, unless you're playing, like, an RPG, you would have, like, a secondary ability. Like, Simon in Castlevania has the sub-weapon, right?
Yes.
But he can't have more than one sub-weapon. Like, it wasn't really until later that games started having multiple sub-weapons, like the Alien Wars Contra 3. Like, you had potential of carrying 2 sub-weapons. And then Mario allowed you to... they got rid of the whole box from the bottom, and then just had the box at the top of Super Mario World.
Yes.
But, like, really, Super Mario World is just... it's a more enhanced game, obviously. But, like, I feel it's an extension of Mario 3, because you can very definitively see the steps from, like, 3 to World with most of its gameplay. Yeah. Whereas the difference between 1 and I'm skipping the Lost Levels and the Doki Doki Panic, like the Mario US 2, but from
2
1
is so good.
I really like 2. I didn't know people didn't like 2 until like the mid 90s. Whenever people were like,
is that a
so
thing?
Weird.
People, oh, I guess, yeah, it's weird.
Yeah,
but...
it's not a Mario game, is what people used to tell me. But yeah. Anyway.
Which it wasn't.
But... The differences between 1 and 3 are, like, they're day and night. Whereas, yeah. Like, it became a set stylistic way that you do things, and then it just kind of evolved from that point. Because they were really just experimenting, I feel, in the early Master System and Nintendo days.
Yeah.
Because it was... more potential to do things with the sprite technology, because they're more complex than like the ColecoVision and the Atari and stuff like that.
Absolutely.
And they didn't necessarily have had time. They didn't right away. They didn't have any experience or time to actually decide how am I supposed to make level. And to me, Mario 3 just really set up how you design a game. And, like, other examples of games that do something very similar where it kind of sets up precedence for you and it throws a bunch at you in a pace that's manageable would be, like, Super Meat Boy. And Mega Man X, the first level of that, is just, like, it... You even if you don't know what to do, but you've played Mega Man before, and you come over and you have like all these newfangled abilities, it teaches you how to use them all within the first level.
Yeah,
and it sets you up for that. Yeah. So Mario 3, really, really like the game design.
Hmm.
Ian,
that's a great pick. Gone Home. Yep. Gone Home was my next one.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of jumped out. I had a couple that I was kind of thinking about that were along the like similar lines, like the Stanley Parable. If you've ever played that,
I've seen people play it, but I've never actually played it myself.
You'd enjoy it. It's a lot of fun. But Gone Home kind of stood out because it had this it had this like crazy vibe to it, like. You go up to this house, and it's raining, and it's nighttime, and...
You don't know if anybody's in it.
No!
Or what's going on.
And I was terrified the entire time, waiting for something to happen.
Mm-hmm.
But you keep going from... Like, it keeps pulling you along from moment to moment.
Mm-hmm.
And, like, each story piece...
Right.
I found was, like... It had like a warmth to it.
Yeah.
And it just draws you along. And it's the way they set everything up, like being able to walk through this person's house, this stranger's house. I mean, it's not a stranger. It's your parents'
Yeah,
house.
It's your old home.
Yeah. So it's not weird that you're walking around touching everything. But man, you can touch everything.
Yeah.
Like you're opening drawers. You're like rooting through their stuff. Like it's great, and I don't mean to sound incredibly creepy when I say that, but you're just like, you're like going through these people's belongings and you're piecing together this story by interacting with items.
Yeah, it was a very unique way of revealing a story, because as you interact with all the objects, it would like bring it gives you that part voice, of the story,
yeah, that
all
like the voiceovers,
which is kind of like your like a journalistic like monologue in your head of different things that have happened and stuff like that, or
yeah,
have gone on and stuff like that as you return home.
But it's just that like the way the house is kind of, I guess, partitioned,
mm-hmm.
to like each new item is going to unlock a different section of that house, and you're gonna, it's just going to keep pulling you from place to place.
It felt like a real home as well. Like even the little, there's a secret like cubbyhole where the magazines are being made.
Yes.
And like even that, like it didn't, to me, whenever I was playing through that game, I thought it was really out of place, but then you find out how to like actually get in without getting through the secret area, and it's like, oh, like, and it all connects together. So it's yeah. like they either base it off of like a real house, or I'm sure they base it off of real homes, but yeah.
Yeah, like it had a very, the house had a very natural flow to it.
Mm-hmm.
It was just, it was, I mean, it's a beautiful home.
Yeah. And the graphics are simple, but they're detailed enough to be effective. Because yes. you can always, like, tell what something is and, like, learn about the object and stuff like that. And because of the interactivity, you can't interact with everything, but it is a lot of stuff.
Yeah, like, I felt like you could touch everything.
Yeah.
It was great.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. One interesting thing about that is replaying through the game, you can play it again through the audio commentary version.
Oh, wow.
It actually goes over some of the design choices that they made with that game. And what's really cool about that, and I actually didn't notice this until it was mentioned in the audio commentary, but like the lamps, everything that is something that would be plugged into a wall, actually has a outlet and like a plug that
is, that's real cool,
the wall. And like usually, like they mentioned, like in first person shooters, like Half-Life, for example, you see like a computer on a desk, but it's just like the monitor and the box
and a keyboard
and a little like sometimes rectangular keyboard.
Yeah,
and it's like, with but no there's keys. There's no wires like connecting the keyboard to, I guess, like yeah, there are wireless keyboards, and there were back then too. But yeah. like generally, like there'd be some cables.
And there's nothing.
And there's nothing. But in this game, there is. Like, even the television, you can, like, look in behind, and it, like, you can see the cables routing in and stuff like that. And there's, like, lamps, and there's wires.
That's really cool. I had no idea about that.
Yeah, and they go into some of the history with.
And this was my pick.
Yeah. I really liked this pick, because whenever you mentioned it, I was like, I agree with this. This is a really good example. And the other thing that they mentioned in the auto commentary, just to mention it, is the magazines, the zines, fanzines, with the publication that they're doing, they actually based it on like some actual zines and stuff like that too.
Okay.
So they went into the history of like of that and some of the music and stuff like that, and why they chose the specific type of like music that they played in the game. But yeah, so
yeah,
if you ever want to play through it again, that I would play the audio commentary. It's pretty neat.
You know what? Maybe. I mean, it only, it's like not long. Game. Yeah, it's like a 2-hour game. But I was honestly terrified the entire time. I was waiting for something to jump out at me. I'm like, give me a knife. Give me something. Like a,
yeah, it was
a hammer.
Free on the PlayStation's network. And that's whenever I got it. And I didn't read anything about it. I just like, oh, it looks kind of neat. And then it looks like a story game. And I really like story games. And then thought maybe it might be like a trick, like it's a survival horror or something like that, and all of a sudden somebody's gonna kill you. But
I had picked it up years ago on Steam because I had a not really good PC, but it was good because I could grab these like awesome indie titles that weren't that didn't require an overpowered beast of a computer.
Yeah.
And yeah, like that was just one I had picked up on sale. I think I got it for like a couple dollars.
Yeah.
And it was one of those like, wow, this was totally worth like every cent I spent on it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
it's a great indie title.
It really is, man. Anyways, what's your next?
My next pick is The Last of Us. I like to call it Always Done Well.
Always Done Well.
There are some larger hallways, but they're really just hallways, if you're really being honest about it.
Okay, yeah, I can see that.
A bad example is Final Fantasy, the PlayStation 3 one.
13,
thank you. Yeah, that's hallways done bad, and this is hallways done good. So the story and everything aside, because we're not talking about that, are great, which does help this game. But the thing I liked most about this game is that even though it was a bunch of connected areas together, and a lot of it was just like zigging hallways and stuff like that to kind of make just connected rooms, essentially kind of like a dungeon crawl, if I'm looking at like the very base mechanic of like how the level is designed, it felt so organic to me. All the stuff on the sides and stuff like that was done well. There's always something to look at. It wasn't like just like gray pacing walls and stuff like that. And I understand it came out like recently, semi-recently, so like you're not going to have that type of stuff in games. Like Halo 1, for example.
I mean, it came out at the end of the PS3's life.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it's still... That's it. I mean, we've had an HD re-release of it, but it's still a previous gen title.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. But I always felt like... I never really felt like I was going through hallways. And whenever a game is able to do that, even though you know what you're doing, it gets extra points in my book, because there's a lot of really, really great games that are just hallways. Like Red Faction's another example of like a hallway game.
If you can blow up the hallway, like that's
sure. Hallway with choices, but I always felt like I was going through a hallway, regardless of the gameplay being really, really good.
Yeah.
I just every single section as well just felt definitive. Even the whole world felt the same. I still felt like I was like in the office building, or like outside, like at the ranch, for example. It still was very designed aesthetically the same.
Yeah.
But they felt all like different places, which is really good too. Which isn't a hard thing to do, I'll admit, but at least it did it well enough that I was like distracted enough to buy all of the stuff around me and stuff like that.
Yeah.
That it actually just felt more real to me. Especially like the one scene where you finally see the giraffes near the end of the game.
Spoilers.
I guess that is kind of a big spoiler, but it's an old game.
All right.
So you like it felt natural, even though it's not, and that was kind of hard to do. Like I guess I was kind of caught in the moment of like the whole event, but like still, it just the going through like that school and stuff like that as well. It felt like actual like school, and instead of just mainly concentrating on the zombies, because like whenever I played Left 4 Dead, like that's a pretty good game, but like I always felt more claustrophobic than anything, and that's a testament to its game design. But like I didn't feel like it was really world building with its levels so much as just like trying to get a certain feeling across.
Yeah, whereas it's trying to panic you from like safe room to safe room.
Exactly. Yeah, and this kind of did both, which was really pleasing to me, because you had the whole, because it was a narrative based game, and it was kind of survivally horror-y and action oriented as well, and it blended all those really, really nicely. And I don't think it would have been as successful if it didn't have as well thought out levels and different areas and stuff like that. But The Last of Us, I really enjoyed playing that game and remember the levels quite fondly.
That's a good pick.
Yeah, even the bosses were really cool, like the one part where the building is on fire and you have to kill or get away from the one guy. That whole entire section, because of the way that the hallways and rooms were like designed, you could like go into different parts of the building, essentially. And it just felt natural to be able to go back and forth in between the different areas and stuff like that, and like avoid everybody on the outside in comparison to the inside and stuff like that, and Yeah, that part was more connected rooms instead of hallways, but you get my point.
I get your point.
The Last of Us. Ian?
Persona 5.
For everything aesthetic and amazing.
It's just... You have the overworld design, which is well thought out. You have a school that makes sense. You have street, like city streets connecting to stores and shops, and it really gives you that you really get that great feel of the like slightly more back alley, mm-hmm. Kind of feeling. Right. Around the
apartment.
Well, not the, I guess your apartment, the coffee shop.
Yes. Yeah, because your apartment's like off the,
it's little... in the coffee shop.
Yeah.
But you have that kind of like, you've got like a little supermarket, you've got the bathhouse, mm-hmm. the laundry place, and then you've got the major city section.
Yeah.
Where you have the, like a bigger, like a convenience store and a movie theater and that kind of stuff. Like, that's all laid out incredibly well. But then all of the individual palaces,
mm-hmm.
they're, as much as they're similar elements,
yeah,
they're so drastically different.
Mm-hmm.
And it's...
Because each is themed off of the persona, right?
Well, yeah, each is themed after your, like, targets, like their personality.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Like whatever their kind of like, I guess, hidden personality would be.
Yep.
And sort of the way they see themselves inside.
Yeah.
It's, well, like a perversion of it more. So, yeah. But anyways, yeah, it's great. Like, the castle is so well thought out, so that castle is the first one.
Mm-hmm.
I'm trying to think of all the individual ones. I should have wrote them down. I'm never that prepared. But like the castle, the bank was amazing.
Right.
Just the layout and everything. It was great. Mm-hmm. And then the individual like working your way to the vault, man. And then you've got the desert with the pyramid.
Yeah.
It's so well thought out. Like, I mean, I know I talked about this last week. Everything about this is so incredibly slick and stylish.
Yeah.
The level design obviously is going to be no different.
Mm-hmm.
But I feel like this is kind of the peak.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the...
Oh, they're going to get better.
Well, yes, but you do have these great amounts of time between releases.
Yeah.
I mean, this came out, it was either the 20th or 25th anniversary of Persona. I think it was the 20th.
Not sure.
I think it was the 20th. And there's been 6 releases.
Right.
In 20 years. Like, that's not a blistering pace.
No, it's not.
I mean, you were fairly close between... I guess sort of close between 3 and 4.
Right.
And there's been a much more time between 4 and 5. Yeah. But yeah, this is, I'm not going to.
The one thing I liked about Persona 5's overworld, and anime does this a lot too. The Japanese in general, the artists do this a lot, but like they tend to like mirror the real life area 110%. Yeah. Because they'll take like, research trips to wherever they're going, and like
that's an awkward thing, taking a research trip to like a high school.
Yeah,
but I mean, yeah, it's
but it's common for them to do it, right?
Exactly. And, like it's
Studio Ghibli does that a lot. Like they went to Europe for Kiki's Delivery Service, and they went to the Suicide Forest for Princess Mononoke for like designing the trees and stuff like that, so that they would all look like real like, they obviously did this with Persona as well, where like the subway station and stuff like that, you actually can see like the subway station as it were in real life.
It feels like a subway station. Yeah. Like you have...
It's modeled after an actual subway station.
But you have various levels. You actually have a little, mm-hmm. like, I guess, market, like shopping area within it. And that all makes sense. Yeah. That's all very real.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I think because the Japanese are so, it's so commonplace for them to do that. They do it in all of their artistic style things, like anime and movies and video games and stuff like that, that you do end up getting that tremendous amount of detail. Like you go down that back alley street and it has all those different stores, and they're not just like front facing buildings like they would be in Grand Theft Auto 3, for example.
Exactly. And you've got like, you have all the different vending
Grand Theft Auto 5 or whatever.
You have all the different vending machines. Well, we won't talk about 5 because 5 is a beautiful representation of Los Angeles.
Yeah.
And it's very eerie, but and deliberate in design. But anyways, yeah, Persona 5 was me. That's I won't go on too long about it, because this one's going to be a long one. JC?
Resident Evil, the PlayStation 1 Saturn version, or the remake for the PlayStation 4, any other consoles that you may want to play it for, GameCube, whatever.
You know, now that you said hallway, like, yeah, now I can see it. So many hallways. It just so, like, this is... Now we're going to talk about connected hallways again.
Yeah, well, these are more connected rooms than hallways, I would say. But there's a fine dotted line that's gray. So what I really like about Resident Evil 1 was that, and just put this on the table, Resident Evil 2 did the exact same thing, but to me, RE1 did it first, even though RE2 was evidently more popular and kind of got more people playing it and had some other really good design choices and stuff like that. But the first one, how the mansion is set up, and it loops around on itself so many different ways so that you can get to all the different rooms in more than one way. You can leave zombies in one area, and then you can always constantly ignore it, because like sometimes you'll get the...
up until that point where you find the key to get to that room that you have to get to.
Yes, yeah. Yeah. Which is more of a thing in the second one than in the first one. Because, like, in the second one, whenever you're in the police station, I feel like it's more specific directions are blocked off from you rather than areas. And in the first one, it's more areas that are blocked off from you than specific directions. Both are true, but I just more so...
See, maybe it's just because I haven't played Resident Evil 1 in... a good number of years.
Right.
But I felt it was very much doubling back on myself a lot.
And that's like,
now I got that.
And you do, and that was part of my point. You do doubling back a lot more in Resident Evil 1 than you do in 2, because you're kind of like, you're kind of like constrained within like one area rather than like three major areas. Sewers and the
lab,
and then you kind of can open up little tiny areas and those with the keys and stuff like that. The first one, yeah, for sure. It's just really cool because, like, although it's relatively a small area to play in, to me anyway, it doesn't feel that it doesn't bother me as much to actually go back to all those different areas, because they're all like blocked off, and it's useful to you to be able to double back to this room through three different pathways or something like that, because you got to get there in a quicker manner, or like some zombies respawn in a certain area in the hallway that's just really thin, and then you can't get through it anymore because you're out of ammo. So shit, I got to go all the way around and avoid these ones over here or something like that.
You hit that magic checkpoint and the zombies have respawned now.
Yeah. And I really like the ink ribbon system.
It was really good.
A lot of people hate the ink ribbon system, especially younger gamers. But it added a level of difficulty to it, because the game isn't like bullet hell hard, or like it has patterns in it, but like it's difficult for different reasons. It's difficult because you have to basically use critical thinking to figure out how you could pass certain things, rather than just learning how to dodge a pattern and then making sure you conserve your ammo. It's a lot more than that, because Like, there are, like, in the newest, in the Resident Evil 2 remake, for example, they put in achievement for less than 10,000 steps. It's like, what? Okay. It's like, I'm not going to do that, but I'm going to watch somebody do that in a Let's Play. And it's like, being able to do something like that is really cool. And, like, another really interesting like thing that people do is like not using the chest, right? So if you know the game well enough because you've beaten it 3 or 4 times in like your recent memory, and you know all the puzzles and stuff like that and where to go and stuff like that, you can use all the different pathways and stuff like that to basically like limit down your time. And it's a really good speedrunning game because you can like go through so many different ways. And I don't really follow this game in speedrunning, but I'm sure that like the first person who like sped run it, like did it in an abysmal amount of time by doing it a certain way. And then it's like, oh wait, you can actually go through this hallway and like less zombies spawn that way or something. Right. I'm just making this up.
I did actually watch most of a speed run on it, and it was only around 45 minutes. Like I was shocked.
Yeah. Cause the game's not that, it's like 4 hours on an average playthrough or something like that. It's not that long.
No. And I mean, I don't know if this was necessarily like an extra fast one, but it was,
or like
it was only around a 45 minute.
But yeah, so I've always really liked the first one specifically because it kind of introduced a way to reuse many of the areas which you go back to over and over again in a way that you don't necessarily mind that much, because it kind of just like builds upon itself rather than like Super Metroid, for example, which is a great game, sometimes has some lulls where you have to go through like a more or less blank area, and all it's fairly large to get to another area because you're backtracking, but you're not really backtracking. You could have just moved it to a different area and just made it really a straight line. Like, same with Metroid 1 as well. Like, it's really cool how you can backtrack and all that other stuff. And I was thinking about putting Metroid on this list, which I didn't. But I just felt like you went through the same area, and it didn't really feel like it added anything to the game, except for a little bit of extra time. Whereas Resident Evil, it does the exact same thing, but I just felt it did it a lot better. It masked it a lot better.
I can agree with you.
Through its level design.
I also really appreciate how they... I find most Resident Evil games, when they start off, or at least the earlier ones, they were kind of scary.
Yeah, they were.
When you, like, right from the get-go, you're like, oh, geez, like, it's intense, and you have, like, no ammunition. But then, like, the kind of the further you go through the game, it switches from this, like, horror-ish to almost more action comedy. Like, it's...
Yeah.
You become way less afraid...
That was...
Of anything.
Yeah.
And now it's more, oh yeah, I don't care about this guy. Like, I've got a shotgun.
Yeah.
He's got nothing. Mm-hmm. Like, that's my real appreciation of the series, is them taking you, like, they really did a great job of taking you from, you know, even though you're a, you know, you're the hero in all of them, and especially in the first one, you're an elite trained police officer.
Yeah.
Right,
special ops that's going in to
exactly
do a job.
You know, you're a badass from the get-go, mm-hmm. but it takes you from feeling like you're not prepared for this at all to, man, I'm like over prepared for this, like, what these guys have got nothing on me. You go from like,
and that becomes more prevalent in like the later ones too, if you like the style of the first games. I don't know if you've played them, but for anybody who's like played the older ones and didn't necessarily like 5 or 6, for example, play Revelations. Especially the second one. It plays like the original games.
Okay.
Yeah.
I didn't play any of the Revelations. I mean, I played 5 because it was multiplayer.
2.
It was kind of the first.
Yeah, it was. Yeah, you could play at the same time. That was really cool.
And despite the questionable racial stuff, the multiplayer aspect of it was quite a bit of fun.
Yeah. They're more... I played 5. I didn't play 6 because I had... no interest in playing it.
Same.
But which is really bad because I really like Resident Evil, but I guess not that much. But
again, another storyline that's way up its own ass.
Yeah. But was I saying? The 5 was more of an action game. The yes. earlier ones were survival horror. And I like, although Revelations, I liked the second one better. Revelations was 2 was an episodic game. A little weird, but like if you get past that and then you just play through the game, and if you're playing it for the first time now anyway, it doesn't force you to stop for like a month or whatever until the next episode comes out. You can just play through the whole thing in like a weekend or something, or a week. It plays similar to the original games. I enjoyed it because you're going through I forget if it's the first one or the second one, but you're going through like a tanker and then like a ship.
Oh, because it's a remake of the Game Boy Color, isn't it?
I never played the handheld ones, yeah, so I don't know.
I do have a copy of the Game Boy Color one.
Cool.
Anyways,
maybe I'll borrow it off you then.
Absolutely.
But yeah, Resident Evil 1 felt like it had really good game design. Your next one, Ian?
Kingdom Hearts. I mean, as a whole, like the not just 1, 2, or 3.
Yeah.
Which 3 I haven't played yet, so I can't really speak to. But
you were so hyped for it too.
I know, and I'm still hyped for it. But the way they take each like Disney property and they bring it to life.
Yeah.
But at the same time, they take nothing away from the original story.
Yeah.
They have this really great way. And I mean, I know a lot of that has to do with writing and probably Disney watching over being like, you cannot mess with our properties.
Yeah. They're very big sticklers about that.
But the way they bring you into those worlds, you know, you feel like you're in...
you're in the Disney movies.
Yeah, you're in that. I mean, with the exception of the Little Mermaid, because that was very poorly thought out. But that was really more of a control issue as opposed to the level itself.
Right.
It's an underwater level. Underwater levels are notoriously horrible anyways. But then again, on the opposite side of that, you had the bell tower from
Hunchback?
No. Big Ben from Peter Pan.
Oh, okay.
There was a whole section around that, and you're flying, and that was done fine. I had no issues with that, and I mean, ultimately, I didn't have a ton of issues with the Little Mermaid. Just the mechanics were
the physics are really weird in water usually,
but the way the levels are laid out, it's just. It's great. It pulls you into that world. It makes you feel like you're a part of it.
Right.
And for somebody like myself who grew up on a lot of these properties.
Right.
It's great. You know, being able to interact with those characters and see like being like, oh, that's you know,
yeah,
this area, or that's like
the feeling I got most from Kingdom Hearts, and most of my experiences from the first one, and I kind of played the second one, but not as much. Like, back in the Super Nintendo and Genesis days, there were all the, like, the Disney video games. And
yeah.
They kind of, like, they were very good games, but, like, it was like, oh, okay, yeah, it's like The Lion King. But yes. I didn't really feel like I was in The Lion King. Whenever I played Kingdom Hearts, I'm like, whoa, like, this actually feels like that world, like you could tell more so that you were like
I don't want to be
more
super,
it was more immersive.
I don't want to be super edgy or anything, but when I got to Halloween Town, I spent so much time there because it was so cool. It was Halloween Town. Like your entrance point was the forest with the trees.
Yeah, and the doors.
And the doors, yeah. And then you could explore in Halloween Town, and you could see locations that were in the movie, and it really brings you into that.
Like, if two companies were to come together to make, like, an IP with Disney, like, Square Enix was the right company to do it with.
Oh, for sure. Like, it was. Ugh. Anyway, I mean, there's not a whole lot to say about it. It's bringing you into the the worlds that you wanted to be in as a kid. I mean, I know 90% of what Kingdom Hearts is sold on is nostalgia.
Yeah.
Both for Square properties as well as Disney properties.
Yeah.
That's 100% what they're selling you on. But like the arena from Hercules, this is the last thing I'm going to say. That was just like, that was great. If you want it, like, that was so many punches to the, like, in the nostalgia. Because you have this, like, the arena and Hercules, like, but then you also have the, you have Square characters as well, because right. you had Cloud, and I believe Sephiroth was in the arena as well. I feel like you fought both of them. I think you fought both of them.
That makes sense.
But,
cool.
Anyways, JC?
My last one is Hexen. The reason why I liked this game, it always kind of stuck out in my mind because it was the first game that I really played where, like, the hub world was noticeable.
Okay.
So
I didn't play a lot of Hexen.
Yeah. So. I don't think... A lot of my friends didn't.
It was just Quake with spells, right?
In levels.
Okay. Okay. All right.
Yeah. And puzzles.
And puzzles. Okay. Yeah. Okay.
The main reason why I like Hexen is because of... Its combat system is kind of cool because it has the three classes and you can play three different ways.
Quick with spells.
Yep.
Sorry. No, I'm with you. It was a really interesting concept.
So the hub world, and then each of the levels that actually spawned off of the hub world, you had to solve puzzles in those areas. And it was kind of like a mesh, just like the Doom levels are, just a mesh of a whole bunch of stuff that's really next to each other. And it's kind of easy to get lost if you're not used to that type of game. But at the time, those were the types of games that were being released. And if you've been playing those games, then you were used to that by playing like Duke Nukem or Doom or Quake.
Wolfenstein.
Wolfenstein. They're all made by the same people, basically. But so it was neat because the puzzles forced you to kind of like go back and forth between a bunch of things, and although kind of annoying in some aspects in some areas of the game, it was kind of cool because like you'd have this entire large level, and you kind of like in some of them you'd have like this much, and then it would just kind of open and open and open and open and open, and then you kind of like open up walls and stuff like that, and then more monsters and stuff would come at you and stuff like that, and then some of them were like more of like more linear and had like sections to that, and you would go like back and forth between the areas and stuff like that, and then open up like different areas within those two main areas that are connected together and stuff like that. And I just always thought that the idea of like having something really simple and then just constantly opening them up sections up to that are connected to it was just so well done that the game really stood out to me. To me, it's like still kind of fun because like I've beaten the game, but I've only beaten it, I think, like a couple times. And like, there's some people who just like replay Quake and replay Hexen and stuff like that. I'm not one of those people, but like, for me at least, it's fun because like, I don't like using walkthroughs all that often. So it's like, how the heck do I do this again? And it's just relearning the whole intricacies of the level and stuff like that. And the game is designed in such a way where it's like, I find it's kind of easy to forget. So, and that's a good thing because then you can kind of go back to it like 4 years later and then play through it again and be like, oh, it's kind of a new experience.
Yeah.
I've never actually played the second one, so I don't know if the level design in that one is better. I would hope that it's better, but sometimes sequels aren't. I guess this is a sequel of Heretic. But
it is a sequel to Heretic.
But yeah, but then there's Heretic 2, isn't there? So I digress. But yeah, Hexen. I always thought that the idea of the hub world and just how they had their puzzles and areas that opened up from it just built upon itself in each of the levels and stuff like that and opened up new areas and stuff like that was just really, really cool. Ian?
It's interesting that you finished your list with a shooter because I'm finishing my list with a shooter as well.
Cool.
Except mine's not the entire game, though arguably it was pretty good overall. But Call of Duty 4, Modern Warfare,
right?
The first with the Modern Warfare subtitle.
Oh, okay.
It was...
So it's like Call of Duty 16?
No, this was actually, I mean, okay, this was Call of Duty 4. This was the fourth release of it. I believe 2 would have been the first one on the 360.
Right.
And then there was 3, which still stuck with the whole World War II. Both of those were in that. And then 4 was actually current,
mm-hmm.
which was a huge shift because all of the other ones prior to that had been World War II.
Yeah.
No matter what their subtitles were.
Mm-hmm.
So, yes, the game overall was really, really well done. I really enjoyed it. Multiplayer and all, I will say that. But I'm not going to talk about anything except 2 specific missions, all ghillied up, and one shot, one kill. Now, I will say one shot, one kill does transition fairly quickly into kind of your standard fare that you experienced through most of the game prior to that. But
in that specific game or in the series?
In the series,
okay,
as a general. Because really, you're just shooting a gun at generic dudes from point to point.
That move, yeah.
Yeah. All ghillied up really switches gears. You know, you're moving with your squad mate in ghillie suits with sniper rifles.
Right, right.
And I think you have a silenced pistol as your secondary.
Oh, okay.
But you're moving through the small city just outside Chernobyl.
Right.
And I'm not going to say it because I will mess it up. But you're there, and it's, you know, they mention right from the get-go that there are still pockets of radiation, so you got to be really careful. And it's all slow.
Okay.
You're not running. You're slowly making your way through. And at a point, you actually get, you drop down, and there's like a column of tanks
mm-hmm.
and dudes coming your way. And you actually like have to like, you can see above the grass enough that you can see their movements coming towards you.
Okay.
And you have to shift yourself around
mm-hmm.
to not be in their path.
Okay.
But you don't fight them. Which is so incredibly foreign in a shooter.
Right, yeah.
You're hiding, and you're waiting for them to leave.
Yeah, this isn't Metal Gear Solid.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. And all you're trying to do is get yourself to that point where you then transition into one shot, one kill.
Right.
Which you have to, you know, shoot a dude, like, a mile away. And what's interesting is that, you know, your spotter mentions right at the beginning that you've got to, you know, it's a huge distance. You have to take into account, you know, your wind and the Coriolis effect, which, I mean, really,
the game engine probably doesn't.
No, yeah, I don't think it takes a whole lot of that stuff into account. But I know that
maybe by Bloom.
I know originally I missed the shot a couple of times playing through it because it does, your bullet does arc.
Mm-hmm.
It has drop to it. And with a moving target, you're not always going to hit him perfectly. It was a great, the 2 levels wandering through this abandoned city. And it was, at the time, it was something that even my wife watched. She watched me play the whole thing and then spent like days watching documentaries on this city and the whole incident and everything.
Oh, cool.
And it's they really capture the city and the vibe of being in this abandoned place.
Mm-hmm.
It's creepy. It was so well done at the time. Even the HD reissue, it's stellar. I haven't seen something like that. I'd never seen anything like that in a shooter up to that point. I mean, obviously, they're going to try to recapture that.
Yeah.
I'm sure there are other examples in other shooters at this point. But prior to that, we really didn't have things that were done that way.
Mm-hmm.
Cool. So, I mean, as far as level design goes, that one specific thing jumped out at me. And as soon as it hit me, I'm like, oh, man, of course, I have to talk about this. So if you disagree with me, let me know. But that was the one thing that kind of...
Awesome. So, yeah, if you have any...
Let us know what you guys think. What
games
what...
that you really like that have really great game design, let us know and why. We'd be interested to hear them.
And we might be interested to play them.
Yeah, for sure. Especially if it's something that we haven't played before.
Exactly.
All right. Our next segment is essentially games that came out that we didn't play until well after, or maybe just slightly after, and we kind of missed the boat or wished that we had played them earlier. Yeah.
In some cases, didn't play at all.
Yeah, and some of them are work in progresses. So I'm going to start, go through my list.
Hit me with your list,
and,
JC.
So
let's talk about your list.
My first games are for the Nintendo. Chrysalis and, The Guardian Legend. Chrysalis came out in 1990 and I didn't play it until like the mid 2000s.
Shame on you for not playing a game that came out when you were like 4 or 5 years old.
Yeah.
How dare you?
But Chrysalis is basically The Legend of Zelda with some enhanced features and a different story, like at its bare bones. The game enhancements that it makes is definitely worth playing. And if I would have had that game, I didn't even know about it until about whenever I got it. And I heard people talking about it on old like chat room forums, but, for some retro games and stuff. If I would have loved that game as a kid, and definitely would have been a game that I would have wanted to play as a like 90 me. And The Guardian Legend, I got it around the same time, so the mid 2000s, early 2000s, and it's an action shoot 'em up hybrid with power ups, and it's actually kind of a more people are hearing about it, but a lot of people still hadn't heard about it even at that time.
I still haven't.
It's really, really fun. I think if I had that game too, it would have probably made me think of like hybrid genres more. And really, okay. I didn't think about like hybrid genres until maybe the PlayStation 2 era or late PlayStation 1 era, where they like were taking like very evident like blends between two different genres and stuff like that, RPG and RTS, for example, with Spellforce.
But it's also a little bit of a question of could you have appreciated it at that point?
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah,
yeah, because I used to play a game called Abadox, which is a shooter, okay. And it's for the Nintendo. It's one of like the first 10 games that I owned for the console. And I wasn't very good at it, but I think I made it through halfway of the game. And like for a 6-7-year-old, that's not bad.
Yeah, no, that's really good.
And the other aspect of it is kind of like an action adventure game like Zelda. And as you know, I played Zelda fairly early.
Every year.
And continually played it, so yeah, I think I would have appreciated it.
Okay, all right.
The next section of my list is a Master System game, Phantasy Star. I missed the boat on Phantasy Star until like late in Genesis, and even then I didn't own the game, but I had played like the second one. Okay. But and I knew a kid who had a Master System in the early 90s, by the time I had a Game Gear. It was just collecting dust, and I was like, what the heck is this? And I'm like, oh, it's the same company that makes my Game Gear. And we played through a whole bunch of games. He didn't have Phantasy Star, but I got this game in college. It was like almost 20 years later. So after the game came out in 88. So like I was way too young to even like understand like playing a game at that point, but especially an RPG. But anyway, whenever I played the game, I really enjoyed it. I found a bundle which had the Master System at a retro game store that I used to buy games from in college, and I bought the Master System, and this was one of those games.
Oh, nice.
I probably wouldn't have. It's bad for me to say this because I like this Master System so much now, retrospectively. If I wouldn't have come with the Phantasy Star game, I probably wouldn't have bought it. So it's a good thing that I was with a collection. But yeah, I bought the game. I replaced the battery, and played through the game and really enjoyed it. It's very similar to Final Fantasy, and I played Final Fantasy whenever I was fairly young. So if I would have had it near the same time, which still would have been slightly late, but like, because I was like 7 or 8 whenever I got, it was 8 or maybe 8 or 9 whenever I got Final Fantasy. But yeah, so if I would have had both those games at the same time, I think I would have enjoyed it just as much.
Fair enough. I mean, because there wasn't, the Genesis didn't have a whole variety of, I guess, Final Fantasy style RPGs.
Yeah, you they didn't weren't have a very time. Well known at any base.
You had a lot more action RPGs.
Yeah, action RPGs or strategy RPGs, like Shining Force.
Yeah, Shining Force.
So the next set of games are for the Genesis. The Contra Hardcore, which came out in 94, and I got this game in high school. I didn't know this game existed until high school, and whenever I knew about it, I had to get it, because I played Contra and Super Contra religiously. I used to be able to beat both games without dying once.
Jeez.
Like, I was obsessed with those games. And I really liked Alien Wars 3 for the Super Nintendo.
Ooh.
And to me, Hardcore is just a much better game. I really like the speed and the graphics and the music and everything about Alien Wars. But just the idea of having the extra characters, having the extra sub-weapons, because you have 4 sub-weapons instead of just like 1 extra sub-weapon. Just some of the bosses are so well thought out. Like the first one, he's like running at you in like 3D and stuff like that, and uses like the rotoscope, like enlarging and reducing the size of like the sphere sprites and stuff like that.
Okay. Where
he's like swinging his arms at you and stuff like that. It was just like so, so cool. And it had everything that every Contra game has. It checked all the boxes and stuff like that. And I just really, really enjoyed that game. But I didn't play it till like about 8 years after it came out. The second Genesis game is Rocket Knight Adventures, which is another Konami game. So I got this game, like, I had just graduated college. I hadn't heard about this game either, or if I did, I didn't really take note of it. I'm not sure if it, like, I saw it maybe Game Players magazine or something.
I feel kind of bad because I own a copy of this. Okay. And I've never played it.
It is really, really good game if you like running gun games.
Okay.
Yeah, it's
that's not what I thought it was gonna be.
Yeah, it's a running gun game, and it's really, really well designed.
Okay.
The music is amazing. The graphics are nice and bright and beautiful. Very colorful. So it's basically you're a neat little animal dude with a sword.
He's an armadillo, isn't he?
Yeah, he's an armadillo.
Yeah.
And
in armor.
In armor.
An armored armadillo.
If I if I had played this game whenever I had the Genesis and whenever it was like new-ish, I would have had so much fun playing that game.
Yeah.
The only downside to that game, in my opinion, is that it isn't two-player. But as I think about that more, I don't really know if it would be a good two-player game just because of the way that the enemies have certain patterns and stuff like that. And the way that some of like the jumping, the rocket boost and stuff like that works, it wouldn't really work as a two-player game, but like it was a really, really fun game. The next game is Shantae Risky's Revenge. I picked the first one specifically just because, well, technically this is the second one, but the Game Boy game is like super rare, and I've only played it emulated, but I didn't play it until after Risky's Revenge. This is my introduction into Shantae. It was on sale on GOG. I bought this like within the past 5 years. It came out in 2010. So I played it like 4-ish years after it came out. It was a really, really good game. It's a platformer. It's really cool because you have like, much like King of Fighters, where like, forget which one it is, but like there's like 96 maybe, where you can go back a level and then you can go back and forth and stuff like that.
Okay.
Shantae does that.
Yeah.
And then there's different areas where you can actually like jump back and then do a whole bunch of stuff and then jump forward and do a whole bunch of stuff and stuff like that.
Interesting.
And it you can use different powers and abilities and stuff like that as you progress through the game. And it's just the artwork is really, really cool. And it's been redone, which is really nice, so that it looks more crisp and like high def and stuff like that. And yeah, it's a really great platformer. The second PC game that's on my list is Skyrim. And to anybody who knows me, I didn't really play Elder Scrolls games.
I feel like they check so many boxes for you, though.
They do, and we'll probably go into this in a different segment.
Okay.
But I had a friend in high school who really, really liked Morrowind, and I had so many issues with Morrowind in a game design aspect.
That's fair.
And I am more of a Baldur's Gate player, which are, they're both RPGs, but they're very different RPGs.
Yes. Incredibly different.
And you're probably guessing, if you've seen all the episodes so far, it's like, oh, Baldur's Gate's more story-driven, Morrowind just has a lot of lore, and...
That's... See, but I found Morrowind was incredibly story driven.
Kind of, but
and it was a lot more. Okay, no, another episode.
We'll do.
Let us know if you want to hear us argue about this.
Yeah. So, whenever I played it around 3 years after the game came out, and my entire Dungeons and Dragons group was playing this game, and there's one player who was yeah, and I hadn't played it.
Man, everybody was playing this
everybody
game.
Everybody but me was playing this game. And it was like more people were playing this game than Oblivion. And it's like Oblivion even had the same problem, and I haven't even played that game. I own it, but I've never played it.
It was great.
Yeah, I understand they're great games. But so my entire D&D group was playing Skyrim. And there's this one guy who like he had no reference or concept of D&D or RPGs, but he had played Skyrim, and that was his like it was like a coworker of one of our friends.
Okay.
And then so he was playing and all of his references were of Skyrim. And he didn't it was the whole group that kind of influenced me to play the game, but like it was kind of funny because like I would always be like, "Oh, like these Thane wizards do this and that with fireball." And he's like, "Oh, you mean like how you can do this in Skyrim?" And I'm just like, "Can somebody answer that for me?"
Maybe?
Yes. But yeah, so like it was kind of fun because like everybody was like making references to stuff that happened in the game, and it's like, oh, can I do this or something like that? And I'm like, what the hell is Faust Roda? And I had no clue what it was. And like I knew what it was, but like I hadn't played the game. So.
Yeah.
Yeah, so I did eventually play it. I decided I was going to play it. But I didn't want to play it on my 360. I wanted to wait until I upgraded my PC so that I could play it on the PC so I could play the high def pack.
Yeah.
And it looks like night and day. Not even like the newest version that they've come out, but like the original like high textures pack. Not the remastered one.
Yeah, not the like
yeah.
HD, I think.
Yeah, so I played the high texture pack version, not the HD version. And yeah, it's just it was a really, really great game. But then again, I didn't end up beating this game. I ended up playing for 120 hours.
Skyrim. You can play it for like hundreds of hours and not complete it.
Yeah.
But I have a sim because I picked it up immediately when it came out.
Yeah.
I actually took the Friday off work because it was a Thursday midnight release.
Yeah.
Waited outside in line in November. Actually, I remember it being super mild.
Right.
I got the huge box because I still have the statue.
That's cool.
And wall of the like dragon.
Didn't it come with a cloth map, or am I thinking of a different game? Maybe. I thought one of the Elder Scrolls game collector's editions came with a cloth map.
Maybe. I might have lost it.
And
now I feel bad about it. But I played it. I seriously played it for like 48 hours. Yeah. I think I had 48 hours by time Sunday rolled around in like playtime. And then I had like a family emergency and stuff happened, and I put it down, and I really have not played it since.
Yeah, but yeah, Skyrim was definitely worth the wait. I really enjoyed the time I had with it. And just one last thing about Skyrim, which I found really, really funny. I play video game soundtracks while I Dungeon Master my campaigns and stuff like that. We had actually been playing Skyrim for like a couple
like actual years.
Yeah, and I hadn't even played the game, but I bought like the digital copy of it from the artist's site.
I mean, the soundtrack's fantastic.
It's fantastic. Yeah. And yeah, this is funny because like I got the soundtrack. It's like, oh, they thought I like played the game.
Oh man,
and
like, it hits no, so I many like the soundtrack. As far as fantasy soundtracks go, it is like on point.
But yeah, my friends were kind of excited at the point because they thought I had played the game because I had the soundtrack, and they thought I usually buy the collector's editions to get the soundtrack. I'm like, no, I just bought the soundtrack. So yeah, and the last set of games are or the next set of games I should say are Sega Saturn games.
Yeah, you got a couple. JC's got a lot of regrets.
Yeah, I've got a lot of regrets for games that I didn't play. So for these games are for the Sega Saturn. I wanted a Sega Saturn whenever the Sega Saturn was new.
You and like seven other kids.
Yep. Sonic Extreme was supposed to come out, but like whenever Final Fantasy VII was going to be coming out on the PlayStation, and I like learned what it was, and I think we're going to go into the
seventh installment of a Final Fantasy game.
Yeah. We're going to go into this specifically a little bit more in the next episode, but yeah, it had so many checkboxes. It had Lycan games that I loved in the arcade. It had a handful of RPGs that looked amazing that I wanted to play that were done by Working Design, such as Albert Odyssey or the Shining games. And some other games like Dark Savior. And a bunch of like action games and some like Street Fighter games and stuff like that. Because there's the like X-Men versus Street Fighter game at like the cinema that I used to go to that had that game, and it was on the Saturn.
That's right. That was the first iteration of the like Marvel versus Capcom.
Yeah it was like X-Men versus Capcom or something like
yeah
that.
X-Men versus Street Fighter
yeah. Yes, but maybe. Yeah, correct. So yeah, there was actually more than one. Some of them were only released in Japan too.
Yeah,
but yeah, it had a bunch of games that I really wanted to play, and Albert Odyssey was one of them. I remember used to Game Players magazine and Electronic Gaming
EGM
yeah. And like they advertise Albert Odyssey, and I was like, this looks like Lunar, and I've told the Lunar story before, and I was like, I have to play this game, and I really really wanted to play that game, and I finally played it. Like, I bought it 2 years ago, but like getting a Saturn is an investment, because like it's always been, and I know it's a lot better now, but it's always been really bad at emulation, so I just didn't really bother, and I don't really like necessarily emulating unless I'm just trying a game before I buy it anyway. So like, you're buying a Saturn, games are gonna cost $200 plus. Like, it's just a fact of life.
The good stuff, yeah.
Yeah, the good stuff anyway. There's a lot of good games that are only $40, don't get me wrong.
That's true. I think I got my copy of Scud for about $30.
Cool. And so I played Albert Odyssey a couple years ago, and just really, really enjoyed it. And I think I would have enjoyed it just as much as any other RPG that I played for on the PlayStation. But retrospect, I kind of don't necessarily regret it at the time, because I would have only been able to get one console. And at the time, it became very evident by all the marketing and like interviews and stuff like that were happening online and through magazines that the Saturn wasn't going to have as many RPGs anymore, and some games were being canceled, and more games that were RPGs were coming out on the PlayStation.
Now,
so,
granted, on the opposite side of that, if you would have got a Saturn originally, it would have been way less expensive to replace.
Yes.
The
yeah. And I would have, like,
the PlayStation 1 era RPGs as opposed to the Saturn RPGs.
That is very, very true. Yeah, but I wouldn't have had as many years either.
So. I guess that's also true. So.
But Albert Odyssey was the main game for the Saturn. The second one is the Panzer Dragoon 1 and 2. I'm a really, really big fan of the original Star Fox, specifically, and Star Fox 2, which I emulated in high school. I do like Star Fox 64, but I just don't like it as much. It didn't really captivate me as much, because it's like, this has kind of been done in other rail shooter games, such as Panzer Dragoon a couple years before, or a year before. But yeah, and the screenshots looked fantastic, and just the technology was just like new and amazing, and it was the type of games that I liked, and I didn't have very many of them.
Yeah.
So they're on my list to get. I was really a big fan, and I got the game like within the past 5 years, Because that's whenever I decided to, like, invest in Saturn and start getting most of the games.
Invest in Saturn.
Yeah, invest in Saturn.
That's the more you keep going, I really think the big regret is that just having to pick up all those things now.
Money, yeah. The last Saturn game is Guardian Heroes. I'm a really big fan of beat-em-ups, especially at that era. Played Streets of Rage a lot, the Ninja Turtles games with the Nintendo, and like the Turtles in Time as well and stuff like that. Double Dragon, a lot of different beat-em-up games. My friends would come over on the weekends and we would play through these games over and over again, or just at least like get further and then get further and then get further.
Yeah.
Because you had to train yourself to get better, basically. Exactly. To be able to beat them. And Guardian Heroes checks so many boxes for that style of game. It's like the definitive like beat-em-up game of its era, and it's still really, really great. I played this first on Xbox Live Arcade, and that was about a year after it came available on Xbox Arcade. I played it with my one friend, and then I was like, okay, no, like, this is a great game. And, yeah, I picked it up, and, wish I had played it earlier. The last two, the Uncharted series. So, I played through 1, 2, and 3 on the PS3, when Uncharted 4 came out. Because I bought the PS3 late, because I had a 360.
Which, I mean, there's nothing
wrong with that. So there's like 2016 is whenever I played. But I played through them all. And Ian actually let me borrow the fourth one. And so I was really late on it. It was late in the life cycle, but it was new to me, and I really like that style of game. It has a really good narrative. And
amazing characters.
Amazing characters, amazing character development.
Yeah.
And just an amazing series. And yeah, like, I played the Lost Legacy the day it came out, so I caught up. But but yeah, so I really wish I had played these earlier. And fun fact about these, Amy Henning wrote them, and I'm a really big fan of the Legacy of Kain Soul Reaver games and the Blood Omen games, and she's the writer of those games. I had no idea she also wrote the Uncharted series. I don't know if this would really have sold the console for me earlier, but yeah, if I would have known that, I would have gotten the games a little bit sooner for sure, because I had the PlayStation 3 for a little bit, and I was like, oh, right, I need to play Uncharted, because they're exclusives, and they're like $10 now, so I'm going to go pick them all up, and so I really, really wish I had played them earlier.
It was like, 'cause
they were better experiences than most of the action-adventure games that I was playing on the 360.
I mean, like, I think for me, the first Uncharted game was like
2007.
40% of why I bought a PlayStation 3.
Yeah.
I mean, it became like I had to when Metal Gear Solid 4 was coming out.
Okay.
Also, that was the last fat console that was going to be backwards compatible.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm like, I have to do it now, but I bought the console with Metal Gear and Uncharted immediately, because I'm like, this has to be, I have to play this. And then I played each one as they were released, because it's just such an amazing story.
Mm-hmm. And the last game that I played that was a little bit late, but not too late, which I mentioned in the last episode, I believe, was the PSVR's Resident Evil 7. I only waited for this. I was a year late and playing the game because I wanted to like wait until I got a VR headset, and I wanted more VR games to come out before I got one instead of just for Resident Evil 7. It was either it was going on clearance and I was getting it, or it was getting more games and I was getting it. And thankfully it was more games and I'm getting it.
Yeah.
Yeah. And like, it was so great. I wish I had experienced it through, the year before, but, worth the wait. Is definitely worth playing. I would say I've never played it without VR, but knowing how it plays in VR and having watched some Let's Plays, which is basically
that's watching it in
it's,
not VR.
It's watching it on VR. If you've played it and you get a VR headset, replay it. It's definitely worth it. Yeah, and three of them that are still active in the pipeline. Alundra, it's. I bought it on eBay last year because I found it for a very good price with the strategy guide.
Oh, wow.
It's a Working Designs game, or they published it in North America. A different company published it in Europe. is kind of interesting. But I really like Legend of Zelda, and it's basically a more puzzle-driven Legend of Zelda game. And it has, like, the artwork of, like, Beyond Oasis.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
I love Beyond Oasis.
So, it has, like, that kind of... It has, like, a kind of cartoony, like, look and stuff like that. It looks like a really amazing game. I've heard bad things in regards to the puzzles being too hard, but I got the strategy guide if you really need it. So, and there's the internet.
Not going to be an issue.
Yeah, not going to be an issue. Witcher 3.
Really?
Yeah, I played it for 10 hours and then put it down. I actually got the 970 whenever Witcher was relatively new. Like, it just came out like 6 months or something like that. And it came with The Witcher 3, so that's how I got my copy.
Okay,
yeah.
All right.
Yeah, and I just never
like
played
970.
It.
970. I'm like, oh, okay,
yeah,
this makes sense.
Yeah, the NVIDIA graphics card. I played it in the winter, like...
That's a good time to play it.
4 months ago or something like that? In December. So, yeah, like 2 months ago, actually.
Okay.
And then so...
Wow, just now.
Yeah. And I've only played it for about 10 hours, and I got distracted by other games. Yeah, I know. It happens all the time.
I've lived in two separate houses since then.
Yeah.
It is... I mean, again, like, we all have stuff on our list that it's like, holy shit, really?
Yeah.
But and it's just, again, this is, like, something that in my head, it checks a lot of boxes for you.
Skyrim would.
Yeah.
And, like, yeah, it's a game I know I need to play, and it's a goal for this year is to play through the game.
So. All right, you've heard it. Well, we expect updates.
Yep. Last game promise of the games in the pipeline are 3DS. I literally just bought this around like this January, actually.
Oh, wow. Okay.
And sorry, it was around September because I got the Legend of Zelda Collector's 3DS. That's like the shield.
Okay.
And it came with Legend of Zelda Link Between Worlds, which came out in 2013. So I literally just got this within like the last six months.
Did that really come out in 2013?
The game, yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
I didn't think it was that long ago.
So I really, really like Toon Link and like Classic Link.
Yeah.
And it's just that. And like even more mechanics and really, really... wonderfully extends like the Super Nintendo game, so it's like, why haven't you played this? But I just didn't have a console, so
yeah,
I was waiting until like the 3DS was like going on clearance so I could just like pick it up and then like get as many games as I could and just like be like, okay, there's a huge stack of games like right over there, and like I'm getting through them. A lot of them are Pokemon games, but anyway. Enough of my list. Ian, take us through yours.
I mean, that's quite a list, man.
Yeah.
Mine's not, like, as intense. You'll find pretty quickly I'm not organized like JC. Mine's all over the place, but we'll jump into it. My first is Snatcher for the Sega CD. This has a little bit of a, I don't know, caveat to it, I guess, in that I did play it when I was younger. There was a rental place that had that rented Sega CD games, and I had a Sega CD.
Yeah, and mature titles to children.
True. Yes, but people didn't really pay attention to that then, so it wasn't a thing.
I mean, I got Grand Theft Auto whenever I was like 13.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, 5-year-old kids play Grand Theft Auto now.
Yeah.
People just don't care. It's weird. But anyways, I played Snatcher when I was younger, but I really didn't comprehend it. I was fortunate enough, as we went over a while ago, to actually get a copy of it, and a friend of mine and I have been playing through it together. We're right at the end. There's a ridiculous boss fight. You use the gun in it like 4 times, and they really in no way prepare you for this boss fight. It's just ridiculous.
Right.
But anyways, the fact is I played it a bunch when I was a kid, but I never made it through the first chapter because I just couldn't understand the story. Mm. But I wish I could have.
Yeah.
I wish I could have understood that and appreciated it at the time, because it's this checks off a ton of boxes for me. It's cyberpunk.
It's Blade Runner of the game.
It's
Well, there is a Blade Runner adventure game, but anyway.
This is like a mashup. Well, it's not just Blade Runner though.
Yeah.
It's Lethal Weapon. You know, there's so many. That's the neat thing about Hideo Kojima. He didn't want to make video games. He wanted to make movies. And
that's too bad.
He ended up making video games and just made them out of making movies that he liked into video games.
Yeah.
So, yeah, like, just everything about this is, like,
yeah,
something I appreciate. And mm-hmm. I wish I could have appreciated it more at the time when I initially started playing it to actually really get into it and be like, oh, yeah, like, this is...
So, side question for you. Have you played Police Knots?
I have not played Police Knots.
Okay.
Now, that is just Lethal Weapon.
Okay, but...
Like, with a robot.
It's... I've heard very similar to Snatcher, so... Like,
well, because it's the... It's, I guess, his follow-up.
Yeah.
It's one of the only Hideo Kojima games I don't have.
Oh, okay.
And I missed getting a copy of it. Somebody had... Somebody locally was selling one for a real reasonable price, because they don't... There isn't a North American release of it.
Yeah, there's a European PlayStation one, I think.
Oh, is there?
Yeah, there is an English version out there. That's...
I didn't know there was
but
an
there
English
is
version.
Like a fan translation of the Saturn one as well. You can like run it using
Saturn. I will have to play it at some point.
Yeah.
Maybe we can play it. Yeah. We'll see. The rest of my list is stuff that I have not completed.
Mm-hmm.
But again, it's I sort of wish that... wow, I did organize these. Okay, anyways. First off, Final Fantasy IX.
Yeah, I'm very surprised by this. Especially the last episode, you mentioned 8 was your favorite. And you
8
probably
is my
saw my
favorite.
Reaction. I was like, okay.
Again, that's my lukewarm hot
take. I love
8.
I love 7.
Final Fantasy
8
is my favorite.
Like, oh, okay.
It is the best of the series. No, I...
The PlayStation series is what you said. But anyway, Final Fantasy
9. Anyways, 9 is... I slept on it. I missed it. I never picked it up when it came out. My wife bought it for me for Christmas, for the PS1, like,
right,
10 years ago, 12 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
It's probably still not opened. I think it's still sealed. I've downloaded it on my PlayStation 3, on my Vita, on the go.
Right.
Didn't
you say you got the Switch
version?
I got
the Switch version. This is my last hope. I've got the PS.
The Switch 2 is gonna have it.
And I did grab it on the PS4 as well.
Right.
Thinking I'm like, oh, maybe I'll no, I still haven't. I haven't loaded
it up. If I ever need
it,
it's everywhere.
I think the most I've played was on either the Vita or the Go. I can't remember which one, but I did put in
the
about
Go. Wow.
I want to say I think the Vita.
Okay.
Yeah, the PSP Go again. I think it was a fantastic handheld and totally underrated, but. Uh-huh. But we'll get into
it
later.
Has no disc drive.
We'll get into it later. This is different story. Different story. No, I just at the time I didn't really have friends who were playing video games, and
you mentioned like specifically RPGs too.
Yeah, like nobody really played RPGs. It wasn't until a couple of years later when the PS2 was released, and specifically Final Fantasy X was coming out. That's the one that really got me back into it.
Mm-hmm.
And the odd thing was, by then, I had met some other people, and they were like, oh, have you not played 9? It's amazing. And I'm like, I've never played 9.
I think for you, from what I know about your history of Final Fantasy, it makes more sense. Because a lot of the people who are saying, oh, you've never played 9, are people who played the earlier Final Fantasies. Because their slogan was back to square one for Final Fantasy 9. Which meant...
Oddly enough, they those people weren't the ones that I was interacting with. Because they were like...
Yeah.
But still, it was just like...
Yeah, my experience, a lot of people who really like 9 is because they really like the 8-bit and 16-bit era games, and this went back to form for them. It wasn't the future fantasy of 7 and 8. It was back to square one, kind of like Tactics was kind of in the same vein of its aesthetic of the original series. More fantasy than like urban fantasy, basically. So, yeah, to me it makes a little bit more sense. I think if it was probably, like, another urban fantasy game, since you had played 7 and 8, you probably would have played it.
I you know what? Honestly, I still think I wouldn't have.
No. Okay.
I still think I would have missed it originally.
Oh, fair enough.
But I wish I wouldn't have.
Mm-hmm.
Sorry. Again, still getting over that that cold. But I'll move on. I don't have to drone on about Final Fantasy IX all day. I will keep you guys updated. I am going to try to play through it on my Switch.
All right, well,
I am going to try to play through it on my Switch.
I'll play through Witcher 3. You play through 9.
All right, we got a deal. We got a deal. I came off way light on that because I've got about 40 hours of gameplay and you've got like 300. So.
Oh, boy.
Well,
no, no, no. 290.
Next on my list is Castlevania Symphony of the Night.
Okay.
Which is funny because we were talking about it earlier, and then we actually talked about, we did mention Castlevania again,
mm-hmm.
but yeah, this is on my list. I actually just started playing it in January.
Okay.
Because I bought collection? The same collection. Yeah, okay. Yeah. I had never played Symphony of the Night. Not having a Super Nintendo growing up,
mm-hmm.
I kind of, well, and not quite understanding the Castlevania games at the time when I was
sure
having a Nintendo.
Mm-hmm.
Well,
this
missed
is a PlayStation game.
Well, no, I yes. Hear me sorry. Out. Hear me out, Jason.
Okay,
let
sorry.
Me get there. Just... I missed out on the whole Castlevania series entirely.
Okay.
So I didn't even consider Symphony of the Night.
You mentioned you didn't have a Nintendo for very long to me.
No.
And then you didn't have a Super Nintendo either.
No, I had a Genesis, which granted, you did point out that a fantastic Castlevania
yeah.
game was released on the Genesis,
yeah.
but I totally missed all of these things. So even seeing it on the shelf, I would just breeze over it and look for something else because the Castlevania series didn't really ignite anything for me.
Mm-hmm. Especially it was in a 3D era of like...
Yeah.
Renaissance of like everything needs to be 3D.
Exactly.
And it was just a 2D game. It's like...
Everything needs to be blocky and
wasn't that,
awkward looking.
Yeah. With
that's
light bulb
what makes
arms.
It great. But I playing this now, I mean, this would have like... the soundtrack's fantastic.
Yeah.
It's... You're the like...
I mean, it's...
Emoist
the
of all...
Vania is in Metroidvania.
Well, yeah. Yeah. I mean, it's... But yeah, like... It's cool. It's a lot of fun. And it the leveling and the items...
Mm-hmm.
It, for me, it really kind of checks a lot of boxes. Like, I didn't really have my first Castlevania, I guess, experience
mm-hmm.
until the Castlevania on the Game Boy Advance.
Okay.
I'd pick that up in, like, I guess the early 2000s.
Yep. Lemonade of Sorrow? Maybe. Was it a green box?
No.
Okay.
It just said Castlevania. Anyways, I can't remember.
You had the other one then. Go ahead.
It was, as far as I know, it was just Castlevania.
Yep.
But I remember playing a ton of it. And I really enjoyed it. I had a lot of fun with it. So just the fact that it took me this long to play that,
uh-huh.
which would really was the turning point in the series,
mm-hmm.
it's kind of a disappointment. I wish I would have gone... I feel like I could have had a lot of fun with it back then.
Yeah, it's kind of like a genre you missed.
Yeah, it really yeah. is. But moving on, Eternal Darkness...
I've never played
for the
this
GameCube.
Either.
I have never played this, and it checks all of the boxes for me. A Lovecraftian.
Do you own this game?
I don't even own it.
Okay, neither do I. This is one of the games where, like, whenever I worked at EB, I heard about it. When I worked at EB, whenever I was in college, and
we won't hold that against you.
Yeah, well,
maybe
it was,
hold it against him. I don't know. I'm not your supervisor.
Discount on video games.
I guess so. Fair
and
enough.
I only worked on like weekends, but anyway, yeah, it was still terrible. But anyway, sell more trade and plays. Okay, whatever, bitch.
But this is just like this really checks all of the boxes,
mm-hmm.
and it's one of those things that anytime I said, "Oh yeah, I've got a GameCube," someone would be like, "Oh man, have you played Eternal Darkness?" And I'd be like, "No." They're like, how have you not played Eternal Darkness?
Okay. People always ask me if I had played, like, during that time, have you played Eternal Darkness or Baton Kronos or something like that?
Baton Kaitos?
That's it. Nope.
Come on, it's a deck-building RPG. Deck-building? Card-based. Card-based combat RPG.
Yeah, it's one of the card games.
With bird people.
Yeah. I haven't played it.
That's okay. You can borrow it.
It's cool.
But no, this is one of those like,
yeah.
I don't know necessarily if I went and played it now, I would appreciate it because there's been, it's been on millions of like, this is a great GameCube game list.
Yeah.
Like anytime you watch anything talking about GameCube stuff, they're going to talk about this and they will talk about all the different elements that would be surprising. Like, the like erasing your save files. Like if I saw that now, I'd be like, oh, whatever, this is expected. Like nothing would surprise me.
Yeah, or like why is it doing this? This is so dumb. Like
yeah, I wouldn't get any of that. Like oh shit, I wouldn't have any actual terror moments. But I mean, I still want to go back and play it because I feel like I need to.
Yeah.
But it's not going to have the same impact on me at this point. I wish I would have played it back then because it would have had that real kind of like
right
gut punch.
Mm-hmm.
But anyways, moving on. The Legend of Zelda Ocarina of Time for the N64. So
the reason why you want to get an N64. Whatever. There's
Mario 64. Wave Race 64.
Wow, I'm surprised you said that.
Superman 64.
Isn't that just Ring Simulator?
And car throwing.
Oh, okay.
No, I didn't have a 64 when I was a kid. I had to make the decision between a system at that point.
Yeah.
Which we'll get into that in a later episode. But I chose a PlayStation 2. No, PlayStation 1. Jeez, wow. I chose a PlayStation. And I totally missed out on this. A lot of friends I have talk about this and have incredibly fond memories of it.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't actually get to experience it until the pre-order bonus for Wind Waker.
Right.
They released, you got Ocarina demand. Of Time and the Master Quest.
Yeah.
What?
Oh, so it was like, there's two of them. There's a red box one, which is the Master Quest one. And there's the other one, which came with the older version.
That was a different,
yeah,
like a different pre-order, I think.
Yeah.
It was back when pre-orders used to be kind of cool because they would give you something for doing it instead of just like DLC.
That you have to pay for anyway.
Or like an extra skin.
It's usually just extra skins that are exclusive.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And just a pad numbers. Anyways.
Yeah. I was lucky. I had two friends who had a Nintendo 64 because I had the PlayStation as well.
Oh, look at you having two friends.
And I borrowed the N64 with like just that game and played through a bunch of it early, like whenever it was new. So it was... I was lucky in that respect.
I feel like I had a really great time playing through it.
Mm-hmm.
And again, I had an amazing experience playing through it, even though I was
near the water temple
end of high school. I didn't, but that's because I played through it with a friend.
Oh, okay.
We kind of like, we really
played it.
We switched off. Yeah. He had an N64 growing up, but I didn't know him when I was younger.
Yeah.
So, yeah, we played through it together, and I had a really good time. I didn't technically finish it because I fell asleep at the end.
Right.
But I was...
Your friend was playing.
Yeah. I was there. It happened around me. He woke me up afterwards.
Hey, look, credits.
And I'm like, oh, but whatever. I mean, I wish I would have played it when I was younger. It would have been nice to have a 64, but again, it's the same as you with your Saturn, right?
Yeah.
You had to make that decision. I don't regret having the PlayStation because I had so many great experiences on it, but this is one experience I would have wished I could have had at the time. But lastly, Skies of Arcadia for the Dreamcast and GameCube, I guess, but originally on the Dreamcast.
Yeah, Legends is the re-release that has some content and edited content for the GameCube.
The GameCube version was actually the first one that I bought. I'd never seen the Dreamcast version.
So did you not know it was a Dreamcast game?
No.
Oh, okay.
I didn't know it was a Dreamcast game until like a few years later. So I saw it, and at the time, really, EB Games was kind of the only game store in the town that I was living in.
Right.
There might have been like one or two, but there was like a couple EBs. So it was the one that I went to most often. I always saw this game sitting there. It was always $65, and I'm like, well, that's a lot of money for a game.
Because
at the time, most games were like $50.
Yeah.
So, with some exceptions around the $65, but they were like few and far between.
Yeah.
So, I'm like, you know what? It's going to drop in price. And I waited and waited and waited, and then eventually I was like, you know what? It's been like, I think I waited a year.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
It's lucky you still got it.
I know, right?
Because I think it was a lower print run game.
I don't think there was a huge run on it. Yeah. But I'm like, you know what? Forget it. I'm just going to grab it. Nothing came out this week that interests me otherwise. So I'll snag this. And yeah, I bought it. I put it on a shelf.
Mm-hmm.
And then a few years later, I was at a convention, oddly enough, and I saw someone selling a copy of Skies of Arcadia for the Dreamcast.
Right.
Which I think it was only, I think I got it for like $40.
Wow.
Yeah, I didn't pay very much for it.
Yeah.
And,
mind you, I paid next to nothing for my copy, but
yeah, like,
we'll get into how I got my Dreamcast in a different episode.
But again, I picked that up and I'm like, sweet, shelf. And I think I've taken out the GameCube version and probably played maybe 5 hours of it two or three times.
Oh, okay.
Like from the start each time. Cause okay.
So you've only really done the intro.
Yeah. Like I've done so little, and this is kind of the issue. And this is like,
other than too many games being released.
Sorry. Yeah. Like it's, I mean, yes, there's so much released nowadays.
Well, even like starting at the PlayStation era really is whenever it really started hitting, where it was just like, there's a new game like every single damn week.
Yeah. And now like
to play.
at this stage, you have like three or four big titles every month,
mm-hmm,
coming out, as well as all of these amazing indie titles getting released. It's so hard, as a dude in his 30s with, you know, a job and a like a family, mm-hmm, like to, I mean, I have a wife and two cats, so
it's a family,
sort of, but my kids I can neglect for like a day. Yeah, like it's hard to find 50, 60 hours to totally invest into something like this. Like that's,
yeah.
Now I did commit myself to playing through Final Fantasy IX, but again, like I'm talking about a game that's what, close to 15 years old.
Yeah, it's about, oh, it's almost 20 actually, because yeah, the original version came out in 2000 for the Dreamcast.
So, well, I mean Final Fantasy IX, but
oh,
still,
yeah,
like,
no, that came out in 2000 as well.
Yeah, like we're getting on 20 years. Like yeah, this is a game that came out 20 years ago that I'm trying to get through now,
mm-hmm,
while at the same time still trying to play new things as they come out. Like it's,
yeah,
it's a real challenge.
Especially as like you play more games over time, and then your liking for different genres grows, and it's like, oh, like you play like a Metroidvania game for the first time, and it's like, whoa, this is a really cool genre, and all of a sudden you start looking into that genre, and it's like, here's 30, 40 more games that like,
yeah,
I could play, and you look and you find three or four more games that you do want to play, so then you pick them up on Steam sale or GOG sale or.
And those are just indies. Like,
yeah,
when you get into it and you're like, oh man, because I think for me, the thing that really got me onto the like Metroidvania style,
mm-hmm,
was Dead Cells.
Okay.
I put a ton of time into Dead Cells. Now, I mean, I know that's also a like roguelite,
yeah, yeah,
kind of deal, but it still has that multiple zones and you can go back, and it has all of a lot of similar aspects to a Metroidvania.
Yeah.
And yeah, like it's real tough. I really wish I had the time to invest in Skies of Arcadia. It checks off, again, it's something that checks off a ton of boxes for me. Mm-hmm. I love pirates. I love sky pirates. Like it.
Yeah. It's a really just, cool concept. And yeah, like at the, whenever that game was released, like outside of anime, it was kind of like the first game that did that. So
yeah, there like, wasn't
it,
a lot.
It's a trope in anime. That's kind of where it comes from. But yeah, it's pretty cool. I guess there was kind of Sky Pirates in Final Fantasy IV, but I digress.
Yeah, like, and it's a good friend of mine. It's like at the very top of his list.
Oh,
for RPGs.
Games. Cool.
And yeah, I mean, if there's a lot of people that really appreciate this game, and I feel like I need to go back and give it the time. The battle system to me felt a little bit similar to Chrono Cross,
mm-hmm,
with the field elements,
right,
and the different colors and that kind of stuff.
Yep.
So, which I enjoyed that. I really liked, you know, working through and being able to exploit it. So, yeah, it's again, it's just that it's that big challenge of finding the time.
Yeah.
as an adult to get through this. It's mm-hmm. that when I was 15, I had all of the time and none of the money, and now I have none of the time and I guess
some more money.
A bit of the money.
Yeah.
But yeah, that rounds out my list. I mean, there's definitely more things that I wish I would have played at the time. And I mean,
didn't make the list.
These are just an example.
Ones that stand out.
Yeah, let us know. I mean, what kind of stuff did you guys miss the boat on? What is there that you might have played now that you really wish you would have jumped into, you know, 10, 15 years earlier?
Yeah, or even if it came out a few years ago and you're only discovering it now, like...
I mean, even one of the things that I was kind of considering at the time was League of Legends, because I actually had friends who were playing it years before me.
Yeah, I was thinking about back in some of the
early
on,
seasons. But then again, I wish I wasn't playing that currently. Because, again, it's something that takes up time. Yes, I enjoy playing it. I really like to sit down and play. But to me playing 2 hours of that is me not playing 2 hours of any other release.
As long as you're having fun.
It's true. At the end of the day, that's all we're out here for. Is we're here to play video games and to have a good time.
Yeah.
That's entirely what we were created for.
Mm-hmm.
but yeah, it's tough. It's very hard to balance out your backlog, the new releases, and
or maybe we just don't play enough games.
And I guess continue also that we're just a bunch of
we just
filthy amateurs.
Yeah.
And now you can be like, oh, it'll be a weird transition between odd beverage to odd beverage.